So today's topic is rectum and anal gland. So coming on to the anatomy of rectum. Rectum forms a distal part of the gastrointestinal tract. It's about 12 to 18 centimeter long and it's divided into three parts. That's the proximal, middle and distal. Distal part here we have the anal canal. So this is a photo. See, from anus to the rectum. Then rectum proximally it becomes sigmoid colon. So coming to the rectum, we have the covering mucous membrane, this plica transversalis recti muscle. So it has a longitudinal muscular coat and a circular muscular coat. We have rectal columns, then they have the anal valves, internal external sphincter. So the blood supply is by the superior rectal artery, which is a branch of inferior mesenteric artery, to middle rectal arteries from the internal iliac, to inferior rectal artery, it's a branch of internal pudendal artery. Internal rectal venous crestus lies in the submucous of anal canal above the level of dentate line. These form the internal hemorrhoids. External rectal vein lies under the skin of the anal canal below the dentate line. This causes the external hemorrhoids. So coming on to the congenital abnormalities, imperfect anus, the incidence is 1 in 4,500 to 5,000 births. There are two types: low abnormalities, where there is anal stenosis, that is the reduction in the diameter of the anus. So the treatment is dilatation. Then we have anal membrane. Anus is covered with a thin membrane. It's a simple treatment is incision of that membrane. The high abnormalities is anorectal agenesis, often with rectourethral or rectovaginal fistula. There's complete rectal atresia. Anal canal is normal but ends blindly above the pelvic floor. So coming to examination, we have inspection, x-ray picture. Infant is held upside down with coin or metal button in the site of anus, and the gas in the rectum will rise to the top, indicate the distance. So treatment is by surgery, incision for the membrane, dilatation, colostomy and reconstruction of anorectum. So coming to the more benign and common conditions, we have fissure in anus. A fissure in anus is a longitudinal ulcer in the distal part of the anal canal. The site is usually midline posteriorly, midline anteriorly 10%, and lateral in Crohn's disease. Midline posteriorly in 80% of the case. Etiology, mostly unknown, but it can be told by passing of hard stools. There's a mechanical cause of the ulcer. The resting anal pressure is raised, but this may be due to the secondary sphincter spasm induced by pain. So it's like a vicious cycle where there is constipation. Because of constipation and passing of hard stools, there is an ulcer. And because of the rectal ulcer, anal ulcer, because of which causes pain, because of the pain there is secondary sphincter spasm, which again increases the constipation. So there are two types: acute, chronic. Chronic is identified by a hypertrophic anal papilla and a sentinel skin tag. So usually symptoms are pain, bleeding, pruritus, constipation and discharge. We have management. Manage for acute fissure in anus is usually conservative, where we give sitz bath, laxatives, anal dilatation, local creams. For operation chronic, excision of the fissure, posterior or lateral sphincterectomy to reduce the high resting anal pressure and relieve the constipation. So here we have a picture where there's a fissure posteriorly. So coming on to hemorrhoids, is a very common condition seen in the anus and rectal. Hemorrhoids are defined as a dilated rectal venous plexus, consists of internal and external component. It's a very frequent disease. Etiology, hereditary is a reason where the weakness of the vein walls are seen. Higher pelvic pressure, pregnancy, that is in pregnancy, constipation and straining at defecation. Symptoms usually is bleeding, very common. There's prolapse, pruritus, pain and discharge. In diagnosis is by inspection. We can at 3, 7, 11 o'clock in lithotomy position. It can be also identified by rectoscopy or anoscopy. The major complication is bleeding, thrombosis and inflammation. So this classification. In classification, we have first degree, there's occasional bleeding only. Secondary is prolapse after defecation and it spontaneously repositioned. Third degree, prolapse needs to be replaced manually. Fourth degree is permanent prolapse with or without inflammation, thrombosis and other complications. So management again is conservative. It can be tried for first and second degrees. Sitz bath, local creams and suppositories. Semi-conservative injection sclerotherapy, infrared coagulation, we can do banding, which reduces the size of hemorrhoids. So definitive treatment is hemorrhoidectomy. It can be open or closed. Open is Millikan-Morgan methods. Now we have new stapled hemorrhoidectomy or hemorrhoidopexy. Procedure for prolapsed hemorrhoids. Advantages is no external skin wound, recovery is rapid, relatively pain free. There's little recurrence rate is higher and the cost of hemorrhoidectomy, stapled hemorrhoidectomy is higher. So complications of this are very rarely rectal perforation, rectovaginal fistula, severe pelvic sepsis and the dehiscence of the anastomosis. So coming to perianal abscess and fistula. Perianal abscess and fistula are two phases of the same disease. Abscess is acute phase, fistula is chronic phase. So repeated abscesses causes fistula. Majority of abscess originate in the interspistic space from infection of the anal gland. So this is a intersphincteric space, abscess, external sphincter, internal sphincter. The intersphincteric abscess and roots of it spread. Fistula in anus usually consists of internal opening, primary tract and external opening. Primary tract connects the internal and external openings. See here we have the internal sphincter, fistula tract and the external sphincter, intersphincteric fistula. Transphincteric fistula, the tract goes through both the muscles. Suprasphincteric fistula, the tract goes above the sphincters and opens to the skin. Extrasphincteric fistula, where the muscles are completely avoided and opens outside. Symptoms are acute, in abscess, pain, fever, in fistula, it's chronic purulent discharge. For acute abscesses, surgical incision and drainage, Hilton's method. Cavity is dressed with gauze, changing every 24 hours. Wound is left open for secondary healing. Here, this is special mention, you need to know about the Goodsall's rule, which is of importance. Perianal abscesses, anal treatment according to type of fistula. Incision, lay open the primary tract, fistulotomy, excision fistulectomy, set on, anal plug, advancement flap, and Kar Sutra. Fistulectomy is complete excision of the fistula tract, and then the closure. This is a picture of multiple fistula. That's the end of the class today. Meet you again. Thank you.